Okay, good evening, good afternoon, depending on when you're going to be listening to our wonderful It's the Empire show. We have a wonderful guest, a very interesting guest today. We have Jim DiEugenio. I hope I pronounced that right, Jim.
It's close
Jim
enough.
Jim co-edited Probe magazine from 1993 to 2000. He then co-edited the book, The Assassinations, Probe magazine on JFK, MLK, RFK, and Malcolm X, in 2003, and his last two books are entitled Destiny Betrayed, second edition, and the next one is Reclaiming Parkland. Today he edits and co-publishes the website KennedySandKing.com. Kennedy's, well, we'll go over that later anyway. Jim, what I'd like to start out by doing this with you today, in keeping with the theme, you've been writing about the JFK case for about the last 25 years. I wanted to ask you what you have been working on as of late involving that.
As of late, about approximately the last 4 years, what I've been working on is a kind of in-depth and at-length study of Kennedy's foreign policy, which means I'm actually studying things outside of Vietnam and Cuba, which is where most people think that Kennedy's foreign policy began and ended. All right, so I picked it up very early in his career, about 1951. All right. And I essentially followed it through the Senate years and into his presidency, which consumes about 12 years. All right. And I studied it in areas that, like, for example, Africa and the Middle East, okay, in addition to, you know, the places that most people study, which is Southeast Asia and Cuba and the USSR, right? And I came up with some very kind of interesting observations, I think. First of all, unlike what some people think, I don't believe Kennedy was a Cold Warrior when he entered in the White House in 1961, all right? And number two, I also don't think that there was a turning. Okay, in other words, some people believe that after the Cuban Missile Crisis that Kennedy underwent this epiphany and he changed. I don't think that's accurate either. All right? And so what I've tried to prove in the various addresses, speeches that I've made on this subject is that Kennedy really had his foreign policy more or less figured out once he entered the White House. And he was one of the very few presidents, who really admired and wanted to work with the United Nations, specifically a guy named Dag Hammarskjöld, who had been chairman of the UN from, I think, about 1953 until Kennedy entered office. And he was, and by the way, I'm going to say something a little radical here. Dag Hammarskjöld was murdered, okay? And if nobody, if you don't believe that, all you have to do is read Susan Williams' book, Who Killed Hammarskjöld, which was published about 4 or 5 years ago.
Well, let's stop for 1 second. Let's just stop. Kennedy admired Hammarskjöld. Why does she think that Hammarskjöld was murdered? What was the reasoning behind it?
Because of the Congo crisis. See, and this is an issue that very few people who study the Kennedy case really study. It was a tremendous struggle from about, I'd say, 1960 went on to about 1965, and it gets very, very, very little attention. But it's one of the things that really drew me into this whole JFK foreign policy issue, because when I started studying the Congo, I discovered a book that hardly anybody had ever read. And I really recommend anybody who's listening to this, if you really want to understand Kennedy, read this book. It's called JFK, Ordeal in Africa, by a guy named Richard Mahoney. And it was basically, I'd say 80% of the book was about the Congo. Now, do you want me to go into that a little bit?
Well, yeah, well, I want to know about Lumumba and Kennedy's feelings on
right,
Lumumba.
Right, yeah, right, so. Okay. All right, okay, this is...
Year. Go ahead.
Let me give it to you in a nutshell. All right, this is what happened. Belgium had colonized Congo for a period of about 70 years, all right? There was a revolutionary struggle going on in Congo, led by a guy named Patrice Lumumba, all right? Belgium decides to pull out completely and totally very quickly because they wanted the newly independent state of Congo to go into chaos so they could then return and take over again, all right? Well, okay. Lumumba decides that he is going to go because of the chaos that resulted as a result of their premature pulling out, that he was going to go ahead and go to the Russians for help.
Right.
And this, of course, makes him a communist in the eyes of the Dulles brothers, brother Alan Dulles, because John Foster Dulles was dead at that time, Alan Dulles and Eisenhower. So he then goes to the United Nations. And Hammarskjöld decides, okay, we're going to help out. And that begins a tremendous struggle, because Hammarskjöld even committed UN troops to the Congo. All right? Now that Hammarskjöld decides to enter the Congo crisis, everybody realizes that Lumumba now has a chance to win. And so two different countries, Belgium and the United States, now begin to plot ways to kill Lumumba. All right.
Okay. Why was our government or our CIA involved in that plot when it was Belgium that was going to recontrol the Congo? You know, tell us why you think.
Very simple reason. Congo was one of the wealthiest countries in the world as far as natural resources go. I'm talking about gold, petroleum, platinum, bauxite,
okay,
cobalt, all right? It was one of the wealthiest countries in the world. And as you know, I'm sure you do, you know, multinational corporations do not know nationalistic boundaries, okay?
Right.
All right? And so that's the main reason why they began to plot to kill Lumumba. All right, now,
Jim, one second. So this is similar to why we're so engrossed in Afghanistan, because there's a lot of natural resources and minerals there, right, that, you know, that our multinational corporations are involved in.
Wait a second, Philip. I should tell you this up front. If I'm not an expert on something, I don't talk about it very much.
Okay.
I'm not an expert on Afghanistan. Okay.
Okay. So the Congo, right. The Congo had the resources, and the U.S. Wanted to have a piece of the action.
It was essentially four countries: the United States, England, France, and Belgium.
Okay.
All ganged up on Lumumba, and of course Lumumba is killed before Kennedy is inaugurated. Okay, and the CIA doesn't tell him about this. They don't tell him about this for over a month. And there's a famous picture of Kennedy getting the news of Lumumba's death, okay, taken by Jock Lowe, all right? It's on the cover of that book I mentioned, Richard Mahoney's book. And Kennedy has an expression of absolute pain and anger on his face when he gets the news of Lumumba's death. Okay? And so, because he had planned on backing Lumumba. All right? And some people think that Alan Dulles realized this. Okay? And that's why he hurried the assassination plots to kill Lumumba before Kennedy got into office. All right? And so, what happens then, of course, is you have this titanic struggle that takes place in Africa, led by Hammarskjöld and Kennedy, all right, to try and keep Congo, number one, free of foreign domination, and number two, not to have the country partitioned, because a lot of people wanted to break up the country, separating Congo from the mineral wealth region called Katanga. And Kennedy was not going to let either one of those things happen. But Hammarskjöld then is killed. All right? And by the way, I have to tell you, I don't know if you know this. When Harry Truman was interviewed about Hammarskjöld by the New York Times, he said Dag Hammarskjöld was really in a position to start doing some good until they killed him. And, of course, the official verdict was an accident. It was a plane crash. And so when the reporters looked at him puzzled, what do you mean? He goes, yeah, you know what I said. I said they killed him, and I'm not going to say anything more.
So it's always, it's funny how it's always a plane crash, too, you know. I
mean, yeah, right, right. That's been a very popular way of them to do these things of late, you know. There's only so many times you can blow somebody's head off in public, you know. So,
yeah. So you're saying that Kennedy was an anti-colonialist. That's what you're saying, and you're saying that he was this way since he was a very young guy. You know, he was only
1951.
He was out of the army.
No, Navy. No. In 1951, he was a congressman about to run for the Senate. So he flies into Saigon in 1951, all right, because he wants to learn more about this struggle going on in Southeast Asia that the United States is involved in, because, of course, you know, by 1951, the United States was bankrolling two-thirds of the French colonial war
right.
And so he flies in there, and he meets up with an old friend of his, a guy named Edmund Gullion. And Gullion worked in the State Department, and he was transferred to Saigon because he spoke fluent French. So he meets him at a restaurant for dinner one night, and he asks him, he goes, well, we're allied with the French. Are the French going to win this war? And Gullion says, no, there's no chance in Hades that the French are going to win this war. And Kennedy says, how come? He goes, it's very simple. Ho Chi Minh has fired up these Viet Minh rebels to the point that they would rather die than go back under the yoke of colonialism. France will never win a war of attrition for the simple reason that the home front will never support it. All right? And that really had a huge impact in Kennedy's thinking. Within a month or two, when he goes back home to Massachusetts, he starts, you know, writing letters to his constituents. He starts making speeches. Okay, he starts going on the radio, and he starts attacking both the Republican and Democratic foreign policy orthodoxy, saying that, you know, this is not really a struggle between capitalism and communism. This is really a struggle between colonialism and independence. And too many people in our State Department don't understand that fact. All right? And he hammered that theme home, you know, for a number of years. Okay, all the way up to his great Algeria speech of 1957, in which, well, that speech is a barn burner. If you haven't read that one, you really should read that speech. In the summer of 1957, Kennedy takes the floor of the Senate, and he starts attacking Nixon, Eisenhower, and John Foster Dulles, saying words of the effect, didn't we understand what happened in Vietnam 3 years ago? Didn't people predict that the French would fail there and that we would be on the wrong side of history? All right. Now, here we are 3 years later, and we're doing the same thing we did then. How many times do you have to repeat something before you understand that you're wrong? You know? And so that...
Question for you. Yeah, let me have a question for you. Cause here's what not to play devil's advocate, because I'm just trying to... But where does his father fit into all this? If his father was the one was bankrolling his whole process of going further and further in politics, and so where does his father? Did his father agree with him on these feelings?
That's an interesting question. That's an interesting question, because after Kennedy made that speech, he was attacked by everybody. Even people in his own party, even Adlai Stevenson, even Dean Acheson. Yeah, right. And so he called his father up, and by the way, his staff collected something like 170 editorial comments that appeared throughout the country in newspapers. That's how much visibility that speech got. Two-thirds of them were negative.
Right.
All right? So he calls up his father, and he goes, do you think I made a mistake? You know, I'm getting hammered from everybody on this. You know, and he says, "No, you didn't make a mistake." You know why?
Says that.
Yeah. He goes, "You know why you didn't make a mistake? Because that Algeria situation is going to get worse and worse, because the French don't know how to snuff it out, because they can't. 2 years from now, everybody's going to turn around and say that John Kennedy guy was right." And by the way, that's what happened. That's what happened.
Well, I can imagine. Yeah, I can imagine that's what happened after what happened with Algeria. But I'm still not, if you don't mind me saying that, I'm just trying to get clear. Because, I mean, I had this thing about the old man, you know, and I read the book, you know, Sins of the Father, you know, about...
Oh, my God. Oh, my God, Philip, please. Ron Kessler? Oh, no. See... Joe Kennedy has been really... I mean, all you got to know about Joe Kennedy is he worked for Roosevelt, okay?
Right.
And he was a big fan of Roosevelt's, you know. So he was a very, very astute, you know, and ruthless businessman. But he was really kind of liberal, you know, in a lot of his politics, okay? And he's gotten a really, really bad rap from a lot of people, all right? But he essentially let JFK be his own man. Okay, you know, to do what he wanted to do and discover, you know, Joe Kennedy was really kind of an isolationist, right? He didn't want the United States to get involved with anything, you know, foreign-wise. But JFK, his son, was very quickly became an internationalist. He thought that the United States did have to intervene in certain places throughout the world, but it should be a wise intervention, all right? And so Joe Kennedy basically let JFK forge his own foreign policy.
Because I was under the impression from the studies I've done on the father that, you know, Roosevelt sent them to be the ambassador to England just to get rid of him. Roosevelt was like, fed up with him. That's what I always read. And because of the way Joe Kennedy was. And when he was in England, I don't know, tell me if I'm wrong or I'm incorrect. When he was in England, he, not that he was a pro-fascist, I'm not going to say that, but he was very strongly pro-appeasement with the Germans at that time. Is that correct?
First of all, he didn't send him to England to get rid of him, okay? He that was actually in a pretty important position, all right?
Okay.
But what happened is that once Joe Kennedy got there, all right, he did not want the United States to intervene against Hitler. All right. He thought that the British could eventually handle that thing on their own. All right. And so the United States shouldn't actually get involved. And he started to make some comments about that, and that's when Roosevelt removed him. All right?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the old man gets a bum rap because of his past as a ruthless businessman and as a rum runner, as they called him, you know what I mean.
And by the way, he wasn't a rum runner either. That's another myth. Okay. So, no, he gets a bad rap because he was an isolationist, and he didn't want the United States to intervene in World War II. All right.
Okay. But he was involved with a lot of shady. You know, he was involved with a lot of mobsters. Let's be honest. Okay. That you would have
listened
to me.
Philip, well, I don't know what books you're reading. Okay, but.
Okay, but anyway, we're not going to spend time on the father too much. I just wanted to try to clarify things about the father's influence on the son. So you've clarified it. Okay.
Okay.
Now, so Kennedy does his speech on Algeria, and so please go ahead. You know, from the.
All right. So 1957, he does. And by the way, I should mention one other thing. He also came out against Operation Vulture. Okay, Operation Vulture was John Foster Dulles's attempt to bail out the French war effort in Vietnam. This was a plan put together to lift the siege of Dien Bien Phu, all right, in 1954, in which Dulles was going to put together a giant air armada consisting of about 210 planes, including three of them carrying three atomic bombs. All right?
Really?
And so,
wow.
Yes. Nixon was going to be the floor manager of this plan with Congress. And so when Kennedy heard about it, he essentially said words of the effect, you know, I'd like Mr. Dulles to come down here and explain to us how you win a guerrilla war with atomic weapons, all right? Okay, and then he said words of the effect, no amount of material, no amount of weaponry can defeat an enemy that is everywhere and nowhere and has the support of the people. Okay, so that's when he first really came out against the foreign policy establishment in Vietnam, all right? Then came Algeria. And with the Algeria speech, Kennedy now became a hero in Africa and certain aspects of the Third World. All right, he became the man that he was like the unofficial ambassador to a lot of these African nations. All right, and so he really begins to pick up this theme about how the United States should find a way that we're not always on the side of the colonizers, even if it means going against our own European allies. See, Kennedy was the first guy to do that, you know, to actually go ahead and in the United Nations vote against his own European allies, okay, when it came to freeing, you know, these countries coming out of the bondage of colonialism. You know, in the late 1950s, early 1960s. Nobody had ever done that before. All right, but he did.
So let's just fast forward a little bit. Okay, so 57 to 60, now he's going to run for the presidency, right?
Yes.
And so this is my question to you, since, you know, you've been painting a certain picture here, you know, and I'm absorbing it and understanding it. Okay, we have what they now call the deep state. But, you know, the deep state's always been there, you know. But now they call it the deep state.
Mm-hmm.
So knowing what we know now, what you've unraveled about Kennedy's ideals in the 50s up to 1960 and the thing with the Congo and with Lumumba, here's my question. How the hell did the two-party system even allow this guy to even have a chance of winning, A, the nomination for his own party, and B, the actual presidency, in your opinion?
Because Kennedy ran a kind of camouflage campaign. You know, on the one hand, he would make all these speeches, about, you know, the struggle of the free world against the communists, and, you know, and we must always be vigilant and everything like that. In other words, to cover his right flank, okay, in a lot of these speeches. You know, but on the other hand, he was doing something else, all right? Okay, and so that's how they didn't really understand who he was until 2 or 3 years into his administration. I guess the first big thing was firing Alan Dulles, okay, after they had those disputes over Cuba and over, the Bay of Pigs specifically, and also over the attempt to overthrow Charles de Gaulle, okay, and also with the murder of Lumumba.
Okay, let's talk about the Charles de Gaulle thing, because you already mentioned the thing about Patrice Lumumba. So talk about, because that's a very important thing that a lot of people don't even know about, the attempt to get his, you know, within his own country and within the international scene, you know, to get rid of de Gaulle. So can you go over that, how Kennedy?
This is what happened. A struggle over Algeria became so violent and so emotional that a lot of the French army, okay, wanted it to be a kind of do or die struggle, all right? And so de Gaulle didn't see it that way. De Gaulle didn't see it that way. He took a look at this and said, you know, I agree with Kennedy, because, you know, there's no real upside to this thing, all right?
Right.
And so he began to announce a withdrawal plan, you know, that France was going to withdraw from Algeria. And so what happened is, in the military, they formed a kind of, I guess the English translation would be secret army. And so they began.
Is this the SAS? Is this the SAS?
No, it was called the OAS. Okay.
OAS. All right. Go ahead. Okay.
The Secret Army in English.
Right.
All right. And so what happened is that they decided one way or the other, we're going to get rid of de Gaulle. And so, and they tried several assassination attempts on him. In fact, that movie, Day of the Jackal.
The Day of the Jackal is a great film. Yeah, it's a great film.
Yeah, right. Okay. And so then when the assassination attempts failed, then they tried a deliberate overthrow of the government. I think that was in May of 1961, okay, where they planned on actually taking over the communication centers, the transportation centers, okay, and essentially locking up Paris, you know, so nothing could move and nothing could be communicated, and then forcing de Gaulle to step down. All right.
Sounds like Operation Valkyrie, right?
Well, you know, I don't know what it was modeled on, but that's what they planned on doing. Then what happened is that this plan was backed by Dulles, okay, by Alan Dulles. It was backed by certain aspects of the CIA. All right. And so the French ambassador in Washington calls up Kennedy and asks him, do you know what's going on here? And Kennedy goes, no. He goes, look, there's stuff the CIA does. I have no idea what the hell they're doing, you know, half the time. All right. And so so he said, but look, I do not want de Gaulle overthrown. All right. And so whatever you need me to do, I'll do. I'll go ahead and sail the 7th Fleet into the Mediterranean, if you want, as a show of support, all right? And so the guy goes, no, we don't need that, all right? But I just want to be sure you're not behind this thing. And he says, no, I'm not, all right? And so that's how Kennedy found out about it, when the French ambassador...
Where did the Joint Chiefs fit into this at that time? Do you know anything about that?
Okay, that's a good question. From what I can understand, there was a part of the NATO military command in Europe that was aware of what was happening. They were aware that there was going to be a coup attempt against de Gaulle, and they didn't tell Kennedy.
Right.
You know? All right.
These are the same joint chiefs who had the infamous meeting with Kennedy when he, about the preemptive attack on the Soviet Union.
Right. Right.
When he walks out of the meeting and turns to, I don't know who he turned to, was it Kenny O'Donnell or his brother, and said, he said, those guys are crazy. You know.
Yeah, and he said, he then left the room and said, and they call us the human race. Okay.
Right. So that was the same, that's around the same time period, isn't it, Tim?
Yes.
Probably.
Lemnitzer. Okay. Lyman Lemnitzer. All right.
But the same time period. Yeah.
Right. So what happens then, of course, is that de Gaulle took to the airwaves, all right, and he rallied the French left, you know, to go ahead and block any takeovers of the airports, the train stations, radio stations, and these people came out, you know, with machine guns and rifles, okay, and they began to go ahead and head off the coup, all right? So that was the thing. So those three things, the de Gaulle thing, the attempts to kill Lumumba, and, of course, the betrayal to Bay of Pigs, that was enough for Kennedy to fire Dulles.
Right. So he fires Dulles, he fires Bissell, he says, I'm going to break them up into 1,000 pieces. That's in
don't forget Cabell.
Okay, yes.
Charles Cabell was a deputy director of the CIA.
So I'm trying to move along here. I'm trying to move along for the people listening because, you know, you're saying a lot of interesting things, and a lot of people, including myself, you know, I don't know a lot of, I know some more than the average person, but I don't know a lot. So the deep state, well, let's ask you. So when did the deep state, we'll call it the deep state, okay? When did they decide that he's got to go?
Well, that's the kind of question that's really, you know, not even me can answer as to when he had to go.
Well, I mean, speculate. You can speculate with all your research. You know, you don't have.
If you want me to speculate, I would probably say that it was two decisions that Kennedy made in 1963 that essentially, you know, broke the camel's back. I would say that, number one, the back channel with Castro, all right, in which he was going to actually work for a recognition of Castro in Cuba, and a combination of that with the withdrawal plan from Vietnam.
Okay.
I think the combination of those two things, you know, that was about it.
So you don't think it was even earlier than that when he passes on Operation Northwoods, and he passes on the preemptive, when the most important thing, wouldn't it be at that time, was the plan that they had to, I heard it was also unanimous amongst the Joint Chiefs, they all agreed on doing a preemptive attack on the Soviet Union.
It wasn't just the Joint Chiefs. Dulles was in the room too.
Yeah, well, okay. He controlled the Joint Chiefs. He was.
Alan Dulles was in the room also. Okay, and he was for that too. In fact, if you read about it, Dulles was actually doing the most talking. All right, and these guys, just to make sure that, you know, the audience knows what we're talking about. All right, this was a meeting in the fall of 1961, in which elements of the CIA and the Pentagon tried to talk Kennedy into launching a first strike, okay, on the Soviet Union, because they said our advantage in international continental ballistic missiles will never be as extreme as it is now. All right, and so if we're going to take them out so that they cannot deliver a counterstrike, this is going to be the most propitious time that we're going to have. All right, and Kennedy, you know, he played along with it for a couple of questions, you know, and then I guess the idea just kind of nauseated him, okay, and he just walked out of the meeting, you know. And so that was, in all of my study of modern history, and my specialty was post-World War II history, I've never read anything about a meeting like that before. You know, where these guys go in to see the president, okay, and the reason they go in to see the president is because they're telling him, we're going to launch a first strike on the Soviet Union. It's the first and only time I've ever heard of anything like that. Really, really bizarre. You really understand, you know, just the kind of mentality that those guys had back then, you know? I mean, it's really, really incredible. Because you're talking about killing, God, I'd say maybe 60 or 80 million people, you know? Yeah.
And of course, you don't know if their facts were even correct about that there wouldn't be any counterstrike. I mean, it's insane. I mean, you know, you watch the movies. You watch Failsafe, you know, and you watch these other, and you know, 7 Days in May, and you get an idea about the mentality of that era, which is, I think it's coming back, Jim. I hate to say it, but you know, anyway, I think it's coming back.
And by the way, the other thing we should mention, it's not just the people you're going to kill, because the amount of radioactivity that gets in the air, you know.
It's insane.
All right.
So anyway, he fires Dulles and Bissell and wants to break the CIA into 1,000 pieces. And you believe, and others too agree with you, that that was his, you know, death warrant. You know.
Well, I wouldn't say it was a death warrant, but just think of it this way. No president had ever done that before. And by the way, no president ever done that since,
right.
Okay? No president ever decapitated, you know, the top level of the – I mean, just look at it this way. You would think that after something like 9/11, you know, somebody would be held accountable, all right? Well, nobody was held accountable, all right? But Kennedy, with the Bay of Pigs, you know, where he thought he'd really been deceived – and lied to, he really did something. You know, when Dulles, remember, I don't know if you're aware of this, but when Dulles was thinking of writing an essay later on, and it was on this subject, you know, he blurted out, he goes, that little Kennedy, he thought he was a god. You know? Well, no, Alan, he just thought he...
Jim, here's the thing. All right, so going by what you're saying, are you researching, and this, my opinion is, because of that, because of the Kennedy factor, and ever since Kennedy, my belief system was there was never a president that was not totally handled by what we call the deep state, okay, or the national security apparatus.
Yeah, so there's a lot of people who think that, yes, that's true.
Well, I think that. All my studies, too. Every single one. LBJ on. From LBJ on, they all, even Nixon, they all were subservient to the handlers of the deep, what we call now the deep state. So, So let's, for the benefit of our listeners, you know, let's go over things that, you know, people already know about or don't know about. All right, so they want to get him out. And talk about how you believe the whole factor of the Oswald factor plays into this. That's an important thing.
Yes, it's a very important thing. In my book, Destiny Betrayed, the second edition, I spent a lot of pages on this whole, because we know so much more about Oswald today, you know, than we did, in the wake of the assassination. All right. There's been a lot of documents declassified on Lee Harvey Oswald, especially from the FBI and the CIA. And I think today, in my opinion, I really don't think there is a serious argument that's to be made that Lee Harvey Oswald was some kind of lower-level intelligence agent, all right? And I can go into all the reasons why I think that's true, all right, but that would take a long time. It's very detailed. But in my opinion, you just have to understand, you know, that the evidence says Oswald was getting training in the Russian language, you know, while he was in the military. All right.
Okay, well, let's focus on Oswald because it is important. Okay. So tell us what you know. He joins the Marines. He's 18 years old, whatever he was. He winds up at the base in Japan, right? At Tsugi.
Tsugi, yes.
But that's where the U-2 planes. That's where the
which
U-2
is
planes
where,
were going out.
Which is where the U-2 was, yes.
And where Francis Powers' plane? Well, that's another.
No. Powers didn't fly out of Tsugi. Okay, he flew out of a base in Pakistan.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I thought he was involved with that day. Okay, so he's working at the base as a Marine, what, as a radar operator?
Yes, as a radar operator.
Tell us your opinion from your research of what happened with Oswald.
Okay. This is what I believe happened. I think that Oswald was recruited while he was in the Marines, first as an intelligence agent, and then to be part of what was called a fake defector program, all right? Now, should I explain what that means?
Yeah, just explain, you know, briefly what it means.
Yeah, okay. The fake defector program was a program launched by the CIA to send Americans over to the Soviet Union, all right, and they were to be masqueraded as certain people who had gotten disillusioned or disenchanted with the American system, all right, and they were going to the Soviet Union to try and start a new life, all right?
Right.
And in reality, what they were doing was trying to get, because the CIA didn't have a lot of information about what was going on inside, you know, of some of the major cities in Russia at that time, but they were supposed to be, in reality, gathering information, okay, on the Soviet Union. In other words, it's called human intelligence, human.
Right? So he was put into this defector program, okay, right?
Right. And by the way, all you have to do is all the irregularities about the way Oswald left the service, you know, his so-called hardship discharge because his mother had a box of candy fall on her head, you know, at work.
Okay.
And then when he was supposed to be hardship discharged for his mother, he only spent 48 hours in Fort Worth when he got back, all right, out of the service. And then he immediately went ahead and went to New Orleans.
Well, let's go back to what he – so he defects. Let's go back
right.
to the whole chronology. He defects and he winds up in the Soviet Union. Okay.
Right.
So
and he winds up in the Soviet Union, okay, and he is taken around Moscow by their state service, escort service. I think it's called Intertourist. All right. And he's holed up at something called the Metropole Hotel in Moscow. Now, the Metropole Hotel is where the Russians put a lot of people that they wanted to surveil while they were in Moscow. And so,
right.
obviously, they did not buy Oswald's story. Okay? They didn't buy it.
Okay.
All right? And so they went ahead, and they had infrared cameras in his room. Okay? They had his room bugged, et cetera. They listened to the interviews he did with certain American journalists who were stationed there in Moscow. And they decided, this guy is not for real. All right?
Okay.
And so what they did is they shipped him to Minsk, which is like 400 miles away from Moscow, and they put him to work in a radar factory. And what do? Knowing that he's some kind of a spy, they put a whole ring of spies around him, plus they bug his apartment. Okay?
Okay.
All right? And so after staying there a while, he meets this woman named Maria Prusakova, and this woman just happens to be the niece of an NKVD officer, which is like the FBI in Russia, all right?
Right.
And she just happened to meet another defector, Robert Webster, all right, when he was in Leningrad, all right? And although Marina said that she didn't speak English yet, Webster swears that she spoke to him in English. So
really?
She then meets Oswald. She then meets Oswald. And on her fourth date, he proposes, okay? Mm-hmm. And they go ahead and decide to get married. Now, I'm going to tell you something very, very, very weird, which not even the white Russian witnesses in front of the Warren Commission who befriended Oswald when he returned, they couldn't understand this, all right? And neither could people in the CIA or the State Department. At that time, now remember, we're talking pretty much the height of the Cold War. It's
right.
A year before the missile crisis, all right? The United States and the Russia are dreaded enemies, suspicious
right.
of everything everybody does.
Right.
The white Russians who testified in front of the commission said, I do not for the life of me understand why they let Oswald leave the Soviet Union with a Russian citizen in at the same time. He said, it never happened. He said, and the CIA did a report on this, saying they couldn't remember it happening either. Because, you know, you let one...
So why do you think it happened? Why do you think the Russians allowed that?
All right.
Speculate. It's just speculation, because you can't prove anything, you know.
Because I think that Marina didn't have to be briefed about what she was supposed to do with Oswald. Okay? I think Marina had a kind of loose affiliation with Russian intelligence already. Okay? Because the reason that they would delay the wife leaving, or if it was the husband, is that they would be... Right. This is what we want you to do. And this is the way you're going to do it. And we're going to give you some stuff to do it with. Okay? And we're going to train you. And we're
Yeah. Sorry. So she's going to be there. So she goes back with him. And,
right.
And then he gets embraced by the white Russian community, right, obviously.
Well, wait a minute. Wait a minute. You're missing that the State Department lent him money to come back.
The State Department lent him money to come back.
Yeah, this is a guy who went into the Russian embassy and threatened
right.
to give away radar secrets.
Secrets,
to the,
right. Now they give him money.
Right.
They give him money.
And they give him money to come back. Okay.
So,
all right.
So then, go ahead.
Well, I mean, like you said, once he gets back to Fort Worth, and by the way, I guess we should explain that the white Russians were the people in the United States who, in large part, were subsidized by the CIA and the
right.
State Department because they were working to overthrow the communist dictatorship in Russia and bring back the Tsar.
Right.
Now, why those people would befriend Lee and Marina Oswald? I mean, that is just, it's ideologically, it's amazing. Okay? It makes no sense at all. But they did. They did. You know? George de Morenschild became his best friend, Lee Oswald's best friend. All right? There's no question about that. And when he got back to Dallas, and of course later, of course, we found out why de Morenschild did that, because he said that he was called in by J. Walton Moore, the head of the Dallas CIA office, all right, and he said, look, we've got this couple coming in from the Soviet Union, Lee and Marina Oswald, and why don't you go over one afternoon, since you speak Russian, and just visit Marina, befriend her, okay, and then become friends with them. And de Morenschild said, if Moore would have never said that to him, he he would have never even knew who Oswald was.
Right.
You know, but obviously the CIA wanted him in some way or another to babysit, okay, Lee and Marina Oswald. All right, so then that's what they do. Then De Morenschild leaves for Haiti, okay, in the early part of 1963, and then their friendship role is taken over by another suspicious couple, Ruth and Michael Payne.
Payne, right, okay.
Yeah, the Paynes, all right?
Let me just ask you a question. Let me ask you a question here. So obviously the CIA, it's very possible that at that moment, at that time period, the CIA already had designs on using Oswald for something other than what he thought he was going to be used for, right?
Well, I think it's pretty obvious what they wanted him to do when he goes to New Orleans. Okay, that's what many people, including Jim Garrison, said was to be an agent provocateur,
right,
for the Fair Play for Cuba Committee.
Right.
In other words, fake like you're...
You're a communist.
Right. Okay, but at the same time, you're doing everything you can to undermine them in the eyes of the public. You know, as many people have said, you know, if you were designing a way to discredit the Fair Play for Cuba Committee in New Orleans, you couldn't done a much better job than Oswald did. You know, and so that's what he was doing in New Orleans.
There's a theory. Tell me if you agree with it. There was a theory that Oswald was also being used. He thought he was being used by CIA or by intelligence to be involved in a sting operation involving gun running for the Cuban exiles, that he was actually being a patriot, thinking he was working for our government to uncover these gun running operations.
Yeah, I think there's some truth to that, because in addition to being a CIA agent provocateur, I think Oswald was also an informant for the FBI. And around this time in 1963, Kennedy is trying to stop, because of the agreement he made with Khrushchev to end the missile crisis, all right, there would be no more attacks on Cuba. He was trying to stop a lot of these Cuban exiles who still wanted to carry on this war against Castro. And so
right.
I think there might be some truth in that Oswald might have been reporting, because there was, outside of Miami, New Orleans was probably the second biggest base for the Cuban exiles to attack Cuba. You know, so Oswald would have been very, very valuable as a source of information on that.
Okay, so we have the assassination of John Kennedy, and we're not going to go into who actually killed him, but that's not what it's all about. But we have the assassination. We have Oswald he tries to get home to his apartment actually, and tell us about Tibbet, and tell us about the whole thing with him being arrested. You know.
Okay, all right. After the assassination, all right, Oswald leaves the scene of the crime, doubles back to the scene of the crime, finally he picks up a taxi after giving it up. An old lady was going to pick it up, and he offered it to her, and she goes, "That's all right, go ahead." All right, goes back to his apartment, all right, and picks up a handgun, and if you believe the Warren Commission, which I don't, all right, if you believe the Warren Commission, he then walked something like 9 blocks, and he encounters police officer J.D. Tippit and shoots him, all right? Now, there's various problems with what the Warren Commission says happened at 10th and Peyton, which was the intersection where Oswald was supposed to have met up with Tippit. Okay, number one, it's almost impossible to believe that Oswald could have gotten there in time for the shooting of Tippit. Most people who have studied the Tippit shooting And there was a gentleman named Larry Ray Harris who spent years studying the Tippit shooting. Put the shooting at about 108, maybe 109. Well, the witness at Oswald's boarding house said that he left at about 104 or 105. Anybody knows you cannot walk 9/10 of a mile in 5 minutes. It's almost impossible. It'll take you, even if you're fast walking, you know, it would take about 14 minutes to do it. So it's very hard to believe Oswald could have been there at the time to murder Tippit. All right. Now, the other problems with the case against Oswald in the Tippit shooting is, number one, the first report on the shells said they were discharged by an automatic. But that's not the weapon that the Warren Commission says Oswald used to kill Tippit. He used, you know, a revolver. The difference, the very obvious difference between the shells for an automatic and the shells for a revolver, and also on an automatic, the reason it's called an automatic is that the shells automatically eject. Whereas on a revolver, you have to unload the chamber and actually empty the shells. All right, so that's one problem, okay? Then there's another problem is that the Warren Commission, when they finally began to investigate the Tippit shooting, all right, they asked the Dallas police, you know, if and when they sent the recovered bullets, you know, to be tested by the FBI. Well, it turns out the Dallas police didn't send any bullets until 8 days after. Now, okay. On a high-profile homicide, you're supposed to send them overnight, and the FBI will do the analysis, okay?
Okay,
they sent
one bullet over. All right, but
one bullet,
Let's backtrack. What?
Okay, go ahead.
No, I want to backtrack for the benefit of the people listening. Now, do you think Oswald knew when Kennedy did get shot and he was in the building, you know, working? Do you think he knew then that he was in jeopardy, himself, Oswald? And is that why he went home to get the gun? And finally, the third question is then who actually killed Tippit? So go ahead.
I agree that once Oswald heard about the Kennedy assassination, and once he began to circulate outside, all right, that he began to understand what had happened. And I think that's the reason he went home to get his handgun. All right, knowing who he was and realizing what had happened and nobody told him what was going to happen. Okay, that he began to realize, I might have a little problem here. Okay? You know? All right, and then what was your last question?
My last question was, by the way, before you answer the last question on Tippit, wasn't there a car that pulled up or something in his rooming house and blew the horn for him? Is that somebody?
Yes. Yeah. There was a police car. Yeah. There was a police car that pulled up outside of his rooming house and honked the horn. You know, that's really, really, really weird. Okay, that it would pull up.
And then
it drove off. Yeah. Some people, of course, believe, well, maybe that was some kind of a signal, you know, to Oswald. You know, that's very, very weird occurrence.
So who actually killed Tippit, do you think? I mean, why was he killed?
All right. In my opinion, because the evidence against Oswald in the Tippit case doesn't add up, okay,
right.
And it's hard to believe he was even there, all right,
okay.
I believe that the people running the actual operation understood that the way to get the Dallas police absolutely enraged so that they would just go ahead and pick up the first suspect and attempt to get rid of him was to kill a policeman. Okay, and by the way, Jim Lovell, one of the higher-ups in the police department, actually said that years later, that, you know, the killing of Kennedy really didn't mean a heck of a lot to him. Okay, but when you killed a police officer, that was blood in your face. Okay, And so that's
Tippett
why
just
I think
the sacrificial lamb, or the reason why they picked Tippett to make.
Well, now that's another interesting question. Because Tippett's behavior from the time of the assassination, okay, until the time he's shot, is very hard to understand. And the Dallas police and the Warren Commission understood that, because they sent three different radio records, you know, because nobody could understand. All the police were supposed to be headed to Dealey Plaza.
Right.
Here's Tippett driving around in Oak Cliff. You know why? You know why wasn't he headed for Dealey Plaza? You know, and so
is it possible that Tippett was actually somewhat in on the operation? And
that's what some people believe. Some people, because at the time, right after the assassination, they said several people, I think five witnesses, saw Tippett, you know, on a side of a trestle, you know, watching the cars come over the trestle, all right? And so they said he just stood there and watched these cars like he was looking for somebody. And then he actually pulled somebody over, you know, and opened the door to look at the guy's face, all right? So some people believe that Tippett had a mission that day. He might have had a mission that day, you know. And so,
is it possible that his mission could have been to find Oswald and kill him?
I'm not going to say that's what happened, but as you put it in the terms, it might be possible. Yes, it could have been possible. Yes,
he kills the assassin, the guy who they later could say was the guy who killed Kennedy. You know, they had the
right.
gun or everything up, the rifle set up for him. You know, all they had him ready as the patsy. So you might as well. You know, it's always good to kill the patsy so he can't talk, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. So finally, because we're getting to the finally, so Oswald's arrested, and we know the thing. He goes before the reporters. I'm just a patsy. Oh, he said, can someone please come forward? You know, because he was reaching out to the CIA to, you know, I need help here, you know. And, all right, and anyway, how does Ruby fit into this? How does Ruby, we know who Ruby was, but how does he fit into being the guy, and why would he do it? Why would he shoot Oswald and then know that he's going to be on trial?
See, I think, in my opinion, they never figured that Oswald would survive, okay, the first day. All right, they thought that, you know, at the very latest, he would be killed outside the Texas Theater, all right?
Right.
And so what happened is, once he started screaming in the theater, you know, I'm not resisting arrest, okay, police brutality and all this stuff, attracting all that attention, you know, it was very hard to, like, kill him, okay, in front of that many witnesses, all right? And so I think that what happened is, that they began to coordinate a plan B, all right? And I believe, and now again, this is my opinion.
I know,
you know,
speculation,
but,
okay.
But it's based on evidence, all right? I believe then that the CIA called in their old buddies, the mafia, okay,
right.
And said, we got a problem here, and it can help you also if we get rid of this Oswald guy, all right? And so, do you know anybody? Do you have anybody down there, you know, who can get in and walk around that police station like he's one of the cops, all right?
Right.
And they go, yeah, we do. You know, and of course, everybody knows, everybody except the Warren Commission knows, of course, that Oswald, you know, Ruby, you know, had done a lot of, you know, work with those people for a rather long period of time.
Yeah, he had a relationship with the Dallas police.
Yeah.
But
right,
why would
right.
he do it? Why would he do it?
Because
I
believe Julianne Mercer's story.
Which
okay.
is?
Oh, okay. It's in the movie JFK.
Julianne Mercer. Oh, the woman that was dropped out of the car, you mean?
No, Julianne Mercer was driving through Dealey Plaza the morning of the assassination. Okay. And there was a traffic jam. And she looked over to her right, and there was this guy driving a pickup truck. And he drove it up, you know, onto the grass and unloaded what she said looked like a kind of, you know, a guitar case. And there was a gentleman with him that she said could have been, you know, Cuban or Puerto Rican or something. And they started walking up, you know, to the grassy knoll area.
No, right.
And so then she was interviewed by the police later, and she identified Ruby.
As
okay.
Driver.
Now here's obviously that's an important piece of testimony. But here's my question. How did they have Ruby's picture that early? How did they know that he was? That's an amazing thing to happen, you know.
Yeah, but here's the question, Jim. I still hasn't been answered in my mind, which makes me why would Ruby agree to do it, knowing that
he was already in on part of the plot. Okay.
We know he's in on.
Let me finish, okay. And they basically would have threatened him with that, all right? And they would have also said, look, you know, this is going to be a short term in the clinker, okay? You're going to get a 5-year term for manslaughter. We're going to make up this story about you, okay? And with good behavior, you'll be out in 3 years. That's
all
better
right,
than...
Okay.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense,
and it does.
And by the way, what screwed him up was Belli's defense. Okay, Melvin Belli came in, you know, and screwed up his defense so badly, you know, and that's what got him that life term. Now Belli, of course, worked with a lot of mobsters, so maybe they lied to Jack, you know, got Belli to get him, you know, a life term. And said, we don't have to worry about Jack anymore. All right? And who knows what happened to Ruby in jail? There's a lot of people who think that he was actually killed in jail, you know?
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, all right. So this is interesting. So tell us, now you want, I mean, your newest book is called, you know, Reclaiming Parkland.
Right.
So we're running out of time, but so that's a book that, tell us a few things that the book might try to cover for the reader that might be interested.
Reclaiming Parkland was my answer to Vincent Bugliosi's book, Reclaiming History, which is then made into a film called Parkland. And so I go into a lot of how Bugliosi presented the evidence, which I thought was not a very accurate presentation, to be mild. Okay, he left out a lot of things, distorted many things, you know, and so it's essentially a reexamination of the Warren Commission's case against Oswald. How does the evidence stand up today in 2000? When I published your book, it was 2013, and the answer is not very well. The last part of the book...
Yeah, go ahead.
The last part of the book is about the CIA in Hollywood today.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, there's not so many people who know very much about it.
Okay, let me ask you this. How authentic or how factual would you say On the Trail of the Assassins by Garrison, his book, was?
I think that book holds up pretty well today.
Okay, just ask.
He didn't. In the light of the new documents we got from the review board, I think most of that book holds up pretty well.
Okay, and finally, the Oliver Stone film. Do you think it was pretty, you know, well done? You know, well made.
Oh, I do an analysis of it in Reclaiming Parkland. I examined the whole first hour of the movie. Yeah, you know, and generally speaking, as compared to most other movies, I think Stone's movie has held up pretty well. You know,
well, I'm going to leave. This has been fascinating, by the way. Is there any so if they want to get in touch with you through your website, it's Kennedy.
Yeah, Kennedy'sandKing.com.
Oh, and you see what I did? I said KennedySandKing.com. Is that
interesting? No.
It's Sand King. No, I'm just saying, I read it that way because it's Sand King. You know, it's interesting. It's a KennedysAndKing.com.
Right.
Right? And I'll leave I'll leave everyone who's listening with the words from the movie, actually Nixon, the Oliver Stone movie Nixon, when Richard Nixon is in Dallas and he goes out to the ranch of you know, Larry Hagman character, you know, the rich oil guy, and they're having a meeting with Nixon there with all his friends there, all the rich oil guys are hanging around with Nixon, and they're talking to Nixon about the election coming up in 64. And Nixon says, he said, no one's going to beat Kennedy in 64. You can forget about that, right? And then this one guy with a Spanish accent says, well, that's if he runs. So, I mean, we'll leave it at that. Yeah, I mean, we'll leave it at that.
Thank you so much.
And we'll be in touch. Thank you.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thanks, folks, for listening to this wonderful interview. We'll have another one really soon, and just remember that your influence counts. Use it.
Good night.